For the past 2 years, the WWE has went out and tried to make SummerSlam the big show, the big spectacle, the WrestleMania, the Super Bowl, if you will, of the summer. In 2015, the WWE failed in their efforts. Despite a lot going into it, the WWE had some matches that just did not deliver, and some matches that did deliver that were ruined by bad finishes. In 2016, we looked for the WWE to try and top whatever the hell they did in 2015. Did they? Well, no. There's only one word, though, that I could use to sum up SummerSlam 2016. There's only one word that wrestling fans should use in an attempt to sum up SummerSlam 2016. And no matter what you try and say, no matter how you try and spin it, no matter how you try and turn the tables and flip it to the other side, there's only one word that any wrestling fan, dumb or smart, big or small, young or old, should say to describe this debacle, SummerSlam 2016. And it is very simple. Horrible! When it comes to big pay-per-views like SummerSlam, one thing that I always emphasize is that every match should have a purpose. Every match should have a point to it. If it doesn't have a point to it, then why should I care about it? I might as well just go watch Raw or SmackDown. And when you look at SummerSlam, you have three matches on this card, and you can make an argument for several others, too, that have no point to them, have no purpose to them. And they just felt like randomly placed Raw or SmackDown matches. See this 12-man tag team match on the pre-show. You could skip it. Was it really meant to do anything other than to give these guys something to do? If that's what you're going to do, then do it at a throwaway pay-per-view. Don't do it at a SummerSlam. And furthermore, this tag team match between Zayn and Neville versus the Dudleys. Again, you can skip it. What's the point of this? What is the purpose of this? You go from Sami Zayn defeating Kevin Owens in this long feud, finally ending their feud after God knows how long, and finally ending this damn feud because I don't want to see it anymore. I've seen it for 7 years. I don't want to see it again. No matter if there's a title on the line, no matter if they're going to compete at three straight pay-per-views, if they're going to main event shows, I really don't care. I don't want to see that again. But you go from Sami Zayn finally overcoming everything, finally winning against Kevin Owens, finally defeating him in the final match at, I believe it was Battleground. And here he is at SummerSlam, and he's wrestling on the pre-show in a randomly placed Raw tag team match that wasn't even good against the Dudleys teaming with Neville. What's this meant to do other than waste a good 5 to 10 minutes of our lives? That's pretty much what this match did. That's pretty much what the first two matches of this pre-show did. And again, we could use this one word, just one, to sum up these first two matches. Horrible! If there was one match on the pre-show that I actually gave a little care to, it was this first match of the Best of Seven series between Cesaro and Sheamus. I'm glad that they're giving these two guys a feud. I'm glad that they're actually making an effort to do something different with the mid-card. Because usually it's just a random US title match or a random IC title match or just a randomly placed Raw or SmackDown match that really doesn't have a purpose, which is how I described the first two matches on this pre-show. Unfortunately, This match should have been on the pre-show. You could have taken out that freaking six women tag match later in the show. You could have taken out one of these tag title matches. I'm sorry, but Sheamus versus Cesaro, at least at the time, mattered at least a little bit. And this match wasn't even that bad. It was actually a solid sit-through. People were actually caring about it. And people actually gave at least a little bit of care to this feud. And unfortunately, looking back at it, this just goes once again into the match with no point category. Because when you look at what happened at the end of the feud, which I'll get to when I cover the Clash of Champions pay-per-view or the Hell in a Cell pay-per-view, whenever the hell they faced off, you'll see what I mean. Going back and looking at this, it's now January of 2017, and this took place in August. Look at where the feud wound up going. They're now a tag team. Unless you're going to do a big match at WrestleMania between the two, which I really hope that is where they're going, because these two deserve at least a little bit of shine. What the hell was the point? And again, this falls into that category of these matches on these big four pay-per-views that have no real purpose. And again, this can get classified under one word. Horrible! One of the things I always emphasize when it comes to any WWE pay-per-view, whether it be a big show like a SummerSlam, or a mediocre small show like a Payback or a Battleground, is presentation. And the WWE surprised me at SummerSlam by introducing a brand new set that looked really cool. Unfortunately, looking at it now, that wound up being the Raw set, which means now you're going to be seeing that at every Raw show and every Raw pay-per-view. Whatever the case may be, I always emphasize how important presentation is in the making of any WWE pay-per-view, and the presentation at SummerSlam was terrible. It was really, really poor. The commentators didn't do enough to sell it. The performers didn't do enough to sell it. There wasn't really a lot of creativity going on. There was mediocre celebrity involvement, and there was limited crowd involvement. And if you have limited crowd involvement in New York, you know you've done something wrong. You know there's an issue, because there is no way on earth that New York, the city that never sleeps, should be silent. There's no reason at all that New York should be dead. And unfortunately, what the WWE had big problem at SummerSlam was the fact that the New York crowd didn't really seem to care, and why should they? The show was presented very poorly. It felt like an episode of Raw that just happened to be 4 hours. And again, you can somewhat get away with that at a mediocre show like a Payback or a Battleground, but this is SummerSlam. This has been around since the 80s. And you need to make this a big deal. If you're going to make SummerSlam a quote-unquote big deal again, you need to present it better. It needs to feel like a big show. And if, unfortunately, we always go back to the one word. Horrible! One of the other things I talk about that I feel is important to any big WWE pay-per-view is card structure and time management. Because the card needs to flow well. The matches that need more time should get more time. The matches that need less time should get less time. The card, like I said, it needs to flow well. It needs to jive well and mix together well and be presented well. Well, unfortunately for the WWE, that seems to be their biggest downfall over the past couple of years. Time management on the show is atrocious. 10 matches on the show, which is good. 10 matches on a 4-hour show is perfect. I think that's literally the way to go in any 4-hour show. You have 10 matches on a 4-hour show, you're fine. Yet somehow, even though one match lasted 5 minutes, one match didn't even happen, and you had some other matches that were really, really short. Not really a lot of really incredibly lengthy matches, other than, I believe, there's one notable example of Styles and Cena was the only match that went over 20 minutes, and yet you still went over the four-hour mark. By the time I got to the main event, I was already exhausted, and I know a lot of other people were. And when I go back to talking about card structure, well, unfortunately, the WWE decided to put one particular match, and I already referenced it, AJ Styles versus John Cena, in the middle of the show. Because anything else after was going to follow, right? Right? Well, ultimately, we found out the hard way that nothing else could follow Styles versus Cena at SummerSlam. Because once AJ Styles versus John Cena was done and over with, the crowd was done and over with, and so was I. Card structure is important, and unfortunately, you put this match way too damn early. This match was the best match on the show, but more on that to come. When it comes to time management and card structure, though, there's only one word you can use to describe it. Horrible! Now that I've talked about the pre-show, now that I've talked about the other elements to what makes a good show, and in this case, what didn't make SummerSlam good, now we can get to the actual main card. And anytime you decide to kick off a show with Enzo and Cass is fine with me. They are arguably the most entertaining thing you have on the roster. That includes even the New Day. The one thing you don't do with Enzo and Cass, however, is pair them with the second most entertaining thing on your roster, because the crowd's not going to know who to cheer for. And this match was a victim of that. Furthermore, why isn't Kevin Owens being featured in a one-on-one capacity at a SummerSlam? Why isn't Kevin Owens getting a signature one-on-one victory at a Big Four pay-per-view like a SummerSlam, especially considering in just a short matter of time after SummerSlam, he is the Universal Champion. But here we go in this match. Chris Jericho gets the pinfall, and Enzo and Cass eat the pinfall. This match felt like a Raw match. Ultimately, the wrong team went over. That's just my opinion. Didn't really think this match should have happened, but it happened. And that's really all I can say about it. Oh, actually, there is one more thing I could say about it. Horrible! Politics always win. And if you know me by now, you know how much I stress how important politics are in professional wrestling. No matter how much you want to deny it, no matter how much you hate it, no matter how much you try and spin it, if you're not a politician, you're not getting anywhere on the main roster. And if you're telling me that there was no backstage shenanigans involving Charlotte and Sasha Banks, you could have fooled me, because why else would this be happening? In all seriousness, Charlotte versus Sasha Banks was not good. Was not a good match by any means. I don't understand why there's so much praise for Charlotte. She's not that great of a wrestler. I don't get why there's so much praise for Sasha as a babyface. To me, she does not work as a babyface. She works as a heel. I don't know why there was so much praise for this match. This match wasn't good. It was choppy. It was botchy. Pretty much every women's match involving Charlotte is that. But yet this match gets praised for whatever damn reason. And furthermore, the wrong woman goes over. And this is just one notable example of Sasha Banks failing to go over when she should have. Why was Charlotte winning here? Why was Charlotte winning in Hell in a Cell? Why was Charlotte winning back at WrestleMania? Why was Charlotte winning at Roadblock? This, to me, this cycle of Charlotte versus Sasha matches that ended with Charlotte winning reminds me of the pre-Women's Revolution Divas. The WWE clearly has no idea what they're doing with Sasha Banks. They pulled a trigger on her on a random episode of Raw, And then you get to the pay-per-view and she doesn't win. She loses it right then and there. And it's like, blink and you missed it. Sasha's title reign is over. You could have forgotten that she was champion. And I sure as hell did. The fact of the matter is, this has happened how many times now? Three? SummerSlam was the first? Come on. Like, either you pull the trigger or you don't. Otherwise, don't waste our time until you absolutely know what the hell you are doing. And this reminds me, like I said, of pre-Women's Revolution Divas. The WWE does not have a clear direction, and that's not a good thing. Women's Revolution? One word for this. Horrible! Anytime the WWE decides to put a mid-card belt on The Miz, once again, I'm perfectly fine with it. Anytime the WWE puts a mid-card championship on The Miz, it's obviously going to mean something because The Miz is the one holding it. The Miz is legitimate in the WWE no matter what people want to say about him. When Miz holds an IC title or a US title, whatever mid-card belt or even a tag team belt, he is going to be featured. He's going to get treated like he matters. Because he actually does his job right. Unlike anybody on today's roster, Kevin Owens. However, this match between Miz and Apollo Crews falls into that what's the point category. Because you give this match almost no build-up. You didn't really give Apollo Crews any sort of a character. You didn't really give him anything to work with. And this is just another randomly placed SmackDown mid-card title match, on a pay-per-view. I really don't know what else to say about it except... horrible! If there was one match on this show that I was looking forward to, that you were all looking forward to, without any question, without any shadow of a doubt, it was this match between AJ Styles and John Cena. The reason why you guys were looking forward to it was the same reason that I was. They tore the house down the first time that they faced off at Money in the Bank, and then they tore the house down in that six-man tag team match at Battleground. These guys, from an in-ring chemistry standpoint, pretty much have it all. They have the chemistry, they work well together. And as a result, you know that at SummerSlam, magic was going to happen. And this is the type of match that I think every Big Four pay-per-view should have. No titles, no extra BS, no club, no Enzo and Cass, no this, no that. Just a mid-card match, or, well, I'll get to my argument in a couple of seconds. Just a match on a Big Four pay-per-view. It doesn't really have any implications on it. It's just two guys going at it. Ego versus ego. Pride is on the line. And in this case, AJ Styles versus John Cena was pretty much everything that it needed to be. It was that one big match that every Big Four pay-per-view, specifically a SummerSlam and even a WrestleMania, needs. And I'm glad that we're getting it again this coming Sunday at the Royal Rumble pay-per-view, because this feud, has pretty much everything. This is the best work on the microphone that I've seen from AJ Styles, and this is some of the best work that I've seen from John Cena, and I'm not exaggerating when I say that. I'm not exaggerating when I say that these two men at SummerSlam put on a five-star match. Take that, Dave Meltzer. This match at SummerSlam 2016 was absolutely incredible. And unfortunately, the only thing that this match didn't have going for it was the WWE, because for whatever damn reason, they decided to put this match forth on the card. Let me be completely realistic here. Let me be completely honest here, if I may. Because I know all of you just love honesty, right? Right? The people that say they love others telling the truth are the same ones that get mad at the truth. Well, here's the truth. you put two world title matches where three of the four competitors, including one of the world champions, is undeserving of their spot at SummerSlam. And I don't care what you say, and I will get to that more later, but if you're telling me that Dean Ambrose, Dolph Ziggler, and especially Finn Balor were deserving of their SummerSlam spots, that they deserved higher billing than John Cena versus AJ Styles, you are dreaming. I don't care what kind of spin you want to put on it. I don't care how big of a fanboy you are of the three guys that I just mentioned, or hell, even Seth Rollins for that matter. I don't care if you guys love them that much. This match between AJ Styles and John Cena needed to go later on the card, and seeing how the main event went, you could even argue that it should have main evented, because nothing topped it. Nothing was able to top it. And looking at the card, nothing was going to be able to top it. And long behold, I was right. Nothing topped it. In fact, this was the last match where the crowd was fully 100% into it. That includes up until the main event of the evening between Brock and Orton. This match had everything. Except, of course, the most important part, the WWE. But, what can I say? It was a classic nonetheless. And for the WWE that decided to book this match fourth on the card, thinking that something else, including those two dreadful world title matches, including that awful main event, was going to be able to top this match, well, there's really only one word I could describe you with. Horrible! Well, SummerSlam was 4 hours. You need a bathroom snack break at some point. And this match between the New Day and the Club, the Bald Jobbers, as we all like to call them, was exactly that. It was a Raw match that didn't really deserve the spot that it got at SummerSlam. This is the second straight year we decide to poorly utilize Jon Stewart, interfering in another title match, and everything about this match was off to me. This match just didn't work for me. It really didn't, quite frankly, work for an episode of Raw, so why put it at SummerSlam? I get that you needed some kind of a space filler in between the Cena-Styles match, which should have main evented. I'm going to keep going at that. And the world title match that came next. I understand that, but at the same time, I didn't really care about it. I don't really think anybody else cared about it. Jon Stewart in this match, I don't know why he needed to be here. I really don't. Obviously, the biggest moment of the match came at the end with the Big E return. Hopefully, this leads to a surprise of him winning the Royal Rumble this Sunday. I know I'm going a little outside of the box here. God forbid a black guy can win the Rumble and main event WrestleMania, but that's another argument for another day. In terms of this match, though, it just goes back to this old saying that I've been mentioning this entire video. Horrible! Oh god, this world title match. This was seriously a Big Four pay-per-view world title match. You decide that the best possible WWE World Heavyweight Championship match for SummerSlam was Dean Ambrose versus Dolph Ziggler. You decide that that is the best course to go. You decide that that is the best route to take. Let me be as completely honest with you as I can. Dean Ambrose, ever since becoming a singles guy, has gotten progressively worse, both as a character and as an in-ring performer. No matter what you try to say about it, Seth Rollins has dramatically improved in every single aspect ever since the Shield broke up. And no matter what you try and say, so has Roman Reigns. I can think of more really good Roman Reigns matches than I can Dean Ambrose. I can think of more really good Seth Rollins matches that I can than I can, excuse me, Dean Ambrose. Dean Ambrose is not fit to be a world champion unless he shows some sort of improvement, whether it's in the ring, whether it is on the microphone, whether he needs a heel turn, whether he needs to be sent wherever. I don't really care. He is not worthy of walking into SummerSlam as the World Heavyweight Champion. And the same goes for his challenger. Dolph Ziggler has shown peaks and valleys over his entire career. This shows that the WWE does not care for him. If the WWE does not care for him, why should I? And why should any of you? It's very, very simple. Dolph Ziggler is not main event material, because just like Dean Ambrose, ever since the time when Ziggler had that world famous face turn that you all marked out for, he has shown absolutely no progression. He has turned into the bland, boring babyface that John Cena is. No matter what you try and say, I don't care that his in-ring action's great, it's not all about that and you know it. In the WWE, you could be great in the ring, but if you don't tell a story, if you don't look like you belong, then don't freaking be here. And Dolph Ziggler and Dean Ambrose, for whatever reason, was the choice to be the world championship match, one of the world championship matches, at SummerSlam. This match, they had no chemistry. There was little, very, very little, if anything, to really care. Nobody cared. I didn't care. There were a large variety of fans that didn't care. The live audience had zero reaction. And when we're in the reaction era, which we are, no matter what you try and say, and you don't get a reaction, you're in trouble. You're not doing your jobs correctly. At least with Roman Reigns, he gets a reaction. People actually care about him. They care enough to boo him. Ziggler and Ambrose got nothing. As far as this match, if you were going to do this match, this should have opened the show. This got higher billing than AJ Styles versus John Cena, the five-star match that mid-carded the show. Unbelievable. And if I had to sum it up in one other word, it would be this.
Horrible!
I mentioned before that the WWE is in the reaction business, where even if you get booed when you're supposed to get cheered, or get cheered when you're supposed to get booed, if you get a reaction, you're over. If you don't get a reaction, you're not. And I talked about, well, actually, I didn't really talk about this that much earlier, but the biggest pop of the night went to AJ Styles, and that's really good. I'm glad that AJ Styles is doing well in the main roster, both from a character and from an in-ring performer. I'm glad that, you know, he's succeeding that well. But when your second biggest pop of the night goes to a returning Nikki Bella, that really says a lot about your main roster. Your main roster needs some help. From character standpoint, from in-ring standpoint, whatever the case may be, your roster needs help. Nikki Bella, returning from injury, got the second biggest pop of the night. Imagine that. WWE decided to be extra generous by giving us an extra bathroom snack drink break with this random six-woman tag team match. And this honestly reminds me a lot of pre-Women's Revolution Divas Wrestling, which was, this match had no purpose. It was really only there to kill time. It wasn't really there to establish anyone or anything. You know, you waited until a couple of weeks later, or a couple nights later, I don't even remember when the turn took place, but for Carmella to turn on Nikki and attack Nikki, you waited to do that on a SmackDown. This just felt like a match with no purpose. It felt like a bathroom break, and that's pretty much what it was. Or, if you want to be like me and awesome and great, you can also describe it in one particular word.
Horrible!
So, we have another case of WWE hypocrisy. We have another case of fans completely ignoring the facts and just focusing on one aspect and one aspect only in hopes that I am going to actually care. If I could be so honest. Ever since Roman Reigns debuted on the main roster as a member of the Shield, it took him from 2012 to 2015, 4 years, if you count 2012, for him to win his first World Heavyweight Championship. But that is a force, according to you people. When Finn Balor debuts a month before SummerSlam, in one night, defeats three others in a fatal four-way, and then goes on to defeat Roman Reigns in order to get this Universal Championship match at SummerSlam, then goes on to SummerSlam and wins the Universal Championship in his first pay-per-view match. That's not a force. Please help me to understand it. Because if you can, you can talk about Roman Reigns not having a character or having a bland character however you want to. What character does Finn Balor have? Other than, oh, there he is with some face paint. That's literally it. It's face paint. And a freaking weird entrance. What's the change? He still wrestles the same, acts the same, performs the same. There's really no difference. And yet, Finn Balor gets praised as a hero and as a great performer. I don't see it. He's had good matches. He's had some good feuds. But they were in NXT. You didn't even give him a chance to develop on the main roster. I don't care that he had all this time in NXT. NXT's the minor leagues. It's something completely different. Kevin Owens, when he debuted, sure, he went after the top dog, but he didn't go after a world title. It took him over a year to do that. Finn Balor does it in a month? And why are you happy about it? Why are you being hypocritical about it? It took Roman Reigns 4 years for him to win a world title for the first time. And that's a force? But here's Finn Balor in a month? And that's nothing? Come on. Come on. You gotta be kidding me. If you're seriously going to argue that, I'm not even going to bother counter-arguing because you're just proving how hypocritical you are without me even having to say a word. However, let's get to this match. It's bad enough that this match happened. It's bad enough that this match got higher billing than AJ Styles versus John Cena. But I put it to you this way. When the design of the World Championship belt is the bigger focus than either of the two participants, you have a problem, and a big one. And I don't care what kind of a spin you want to put on it and say, oh, it's the New York crowd, you know how rowdy they can be, and you try and spin it so that way Finn Balor and Seth Rollins look like angels. Well, let me put it to you this way. The freaking belt got a bigger reaction than Balor winning the world title, than Rollins being in this match. There's no way you can spin that. And there's no way you can defend that. That's really, really sad. And Let me go back for a second and backtrack and talk more about NXT. NXT is designed to prepare you for the main roster. That doesn't mean everything from NXT carries over onto the main roster, because if it did, Neville would be in a much better spot. Sami Zayn would be in a much better spot. Enzo and Cass wouldn't be irrelevant like they are right now. Rusev wouldn't be thrown in a random tag team with Jinder freaking Mahal. In baseball, do minor league stats carry over to the major leagues? So that way when you enter the major leagues, do the announcers sit there and say, oh, well, he had 40 home runs in the minor leagues, so he has 40 home runs this season. No. That doesn't make any sense. There's a reason why it's called the minor leagues. It's different from the majors. Once you get to the majors, you're a different person, doing different things. It may prepare you for the major leagues. In this case, NXT may prepare you for the main roster, but it is not, that doesn't mean it carries over to the main roster. Because if it did, so many other guys would be in much better spots than they are now. So let's be completely honest here. Finn Balor, you guys may love him. He's not deserving of the spot. Seth Rollins, out of the four people that I mentioned, was more deserving of the spot than either of any of the three. And that's not really saying much. But Kevin Owens was put in a random tag team match with really no purpose instead of being given, one of these spots. It could have been Owens versus Rollins here. Instead, you did Rollins versus Balor, with Balor winning, just so that one day later he can vacate the title. And I'm not going to get into the Seth Rollins injury stuff. I'll just say this. It's just another match using that same move, which injured another person. It's just the best way I can describe it. I'm not saying it's Balor's fault. I'm not saying it's Rollins' fault. I'm saying the move in the course of a year has injured two people, costing one of them his career. So, there you have it. In terms of this match, I guess this match was saved by it being at least passable. But if you're going strictly off of in-ring action, you're not going to get anything else from me, honestly, because Balor wasn't even deserving of the spot. This match should not have happened. That's just me. You can disagree with it. You have every right to, but that's just me, and that's just my reality. And that's just, in one simple word, horrible. One of the most bipolar feuds heading into SummerSlam and leaving SummerSlam was this feud between Roman Reigns and Rusev. A lot of people just did not know the base of the feud, didn't really understand it. It kind of went here, there, and everywhere, and I'll give you that. I'll give you that. The basis of the feud, I guess you can say, was Roman Reigns making fun of Rusev's wife, Lana. So, by default, you would think that Rusev, trying to defend his wife, would be angry about that, and he would go after Roman Reigns in a fight. Well, that's exactly what they did here at SummerSlam. And I don't really understand how you can hate it. Because this is actually something that makes a little bit of sense. That Rusev would go after Roman Reigns in this way, and that Roman Reigns would fight back. This feud's personal. I wish that Roman Reigns would get a little bit more if Rusev can get a little more personal with Roman Reigns, maybe mention his family. But instead, it's kind of one-sided. So Rusev attacks Roman Reigns, and we get this fight. We don't officially get a match. I don't understand how you people can be angry about this. You hate Roman Reigns so much, you hate him as a performer, then why are you angry about him not competing? It's almost as if you actually care about him.
wouldn't that kind of make you a little bit hypocritical? Just a thought. But on the positive note, I actually like that the WWE went this direction. And I actually like that we didn't get this match because we've already seen so much action, too much wrestling on this SummerSlam show. And it was just way too damn much. And I didn't want to sit through this another standard wrestling match. I wanted to see just them fight, and that's what they did. Unfortunately, when we get to Clash of Champions and that review, we get the complete opposite. But more on that to come. But a good job by the WWE. Was it enough to keep me interested in the show? Not really. Was it enough to keep you interested in the show? Obviously not. You know, this match didn't happen, which is good, because again, way too much wrestling, which can only be classified as
horrible.
So we finally get to this big interpromotional main event match between Brock Lesnar and Randy Orton. A match that we've seen in 2002, or I believe we've seen it. Whatever. Whatever the case may be. We get this match between Brock and Orton. Big match. Big enough, obviously, according to the WWE, to main event the show. And the highly anticipated match between these two turned into a debacle. It's very, very typical and very, very common when Brock Lesnar is around. And when Brock Lesnar is in a match, that's bound to happen. And unfortunately, I was right. It happened. This match was brutal. And I don't mean brutal in a violent way. I mean brutal in a bad way. Brock versus Orton was just so slow. It was mostly one-sided. Orton got a couple RKOs in, and that was it. It was really, really just all Brock smash the entire match with the most ridiculous decision I've seen in years. It's one thing to have Brock win, which was bound to happen anyway because Randy Orton doesn't really need the win. Well, arguably, Brock doesn't need the win either. But you know the direction they were going to go. Brock was going to win this match no matter what happened, no matter what spin you wanted to put on it. But here's my thing. We suspend him from the UFC, a company that he's probably never going to compete for again. I think in an interview he said he's done with MMA, but we've suspended him from the UFC. We don't suspend him from the WWE. We instead reward him with a main event Big Four pay-per-view match against a big-time opponent, and we pretty much just have him control the finish of the match. So now the WWE is setting out and intentionally harming their performers. All because Brock Lesnar is the man. Brock Lesnar is the best. Brock Lesnar is Brock Lesnar. And we're supposed to care about him and nobody else. Does that not bother anybody else? I understand that this finish was different. But different doesn't always mean good. And now you're intentionally putting your performers in harm's way, all because you want to promote Brock Lesnar, who, may I remind you, 12 years before, left the company high and dry in the middle of his push. Brock Lesnar was going to be the top guy in the company for years, and instead, he left. Because he wanted to try and go play professional football. See how that went. But Randy Orton did not need this. Brock Lesnar did not need this win. WWE did not need this match. They could have skipped it. They could have did it in another show, in another way. I didn't want to see it. I'm pissed off at the decision of how the match ended, of how the post-match attack on Shane McMahon had no payoff. Nothing about this match worked. And I'm tired of the Brock bots defending him and defending this. And if you're a Randy Orton fan, I'd be pissed. And if you're a WWE fan, I would also be pissed. Because this is not a SummerSlam main event. Nor is it a UFC main event. This is a wrestling, a WWE main event. Why are we intentionally harming our performers? All because Brock is God's gift to Earth? Nothing about this worked. And honestly, it just put a sour ending, a terrible ending, to a terrible show. And for the second straight year, WWE attempted to make SummerSlam the WrestleMania of the summer. And for the second straight year, they failed. And probably even worse than 2015. And if I could sum up this entire match, this entire show, from pre-show to main event, it can only be in one word.
Horrible!